Injection.
Buongiorno a tutti e benvenuti alla presentazione finale del corso Workshop Innovative System tenuto al Politecnico di Torino dell'anno 2020 e 2021. Io sono Yuri Ardesi e ho il piacere di presentare questa presentazione finale che per la prima volta si terrà su YouTube in diretta streaming. Inizio dicendo che cos'è il workshop. Il workshop è essenzialmente un progetto in cui studenti appartenenti a due corsi del corso di laurea in ingegneria elettronica svolgono alcuni progetti relativamente complicati e su alcuni topic ritenuti abbastanza challenging. In particolare questi corsi sono sistemi elettronici a basso consumo, tenuto dal professor Maurizio Zamboni, e il corso Integrated System Technology, tenuto dal professor Gianluca Piccinini. Un po' di storia. Il workshop arriva quest'anno alla sua terza edizione, ma ha già visto appunto due edizioni precedenti. La prima, nel 2018-2019, in cui è stato fatto il design architetturale e fisico di dispositivi Logic in Memory. Il secondo workshop, dove è stato fatto di nuovo un design architetturale e fisico legato alle reti neurali. E il terzo workshop, ossia quello di quest'anno, in cui ci focalizziamo sulle unità aritmetiche. Anche in questo caso un design di tipo architetturale e fisico. Arriveremo poi alla quarta edizione per il prossimo anno che stiamo pianificando in questo periodo. In particolare il workshop di quest'anno è stato suddiviso in due parti. Nella prima parte gli studenti hanno inizialmente fatto uno studio di letteratura per quel che riguarda le unità aritmetiche, dopodiché hanno provato a fare un design inizialmente comportamentale di queste unità, andando poi a ottimizzare sempre questi dispositivi, sia per quel che riguarda la potenza, sia per quel che riguarda la velocità, e un gruppo di questi tre è andato a ottimizzare ad entrambe le cose, sia velocità, sia il consumo di potenza. Dopodiché si è passata alla parte di sintesi, place and route, e alla seconda parte del workshop, dove la tecnologia è diventata più importante, quindi non si trattava più di un design funzionale, ma si è andato a lavorare su una tecnologia a 45 nanometri inizialmente e poi su delle tecnologie emergenti, in particolare GAFET, FinFET e TFET. In particolare passiamo ai tre gruppi che quest'anno hanno partecipato al workshop. Il gruppo numero uno, che si è occupato della riduzione del prodotto potenza-ritardo, che ha come componenti Alessandro Barrera, Paolo Cacciatore, Hui Kai Liu. Il secondo gruppo, che si è occupato della riduzione di potenza, Alessandro Lovesio, Lorenzo Poloni e Simone Ponte. E il terzo gruppo, che invece ha lavorato sull'high speed Electronics, quindi Luca Norisso, Gabriele Perrone e Deborah Volpe. I tre gruppi hanno appunto lavorato sulle tre tecnologie, FinFET, TFET e GAFET. Ora, prima di introdurvi direttamente alle presentazioni dei gruppi, vorrei dare la parola ai professori che hanno contribuito in questo workshop. Quindi introdurrei il professor Maurizio Zamboni e il professor Gianluca Piccinini, se vogliono dire alcune parole. Grazie.
Bene, Gianluca, parti tu come responsabile del corso.
Allora, volentieri. Allora, grazie Yuri. Allora, è chiaro che oggi è una giornata conclusiva per questa attività e quindi mi sembra giusto dire due parole in generale. Allora, giustamente siamo ormai all'inizio della quarta edizione e quindi ricordo bene quando avevamo cominciato nel 2017, quindi non posso che ringraziare Maurizio nella sua veste attuale di coordinatore di collegio per aver mantenuto ovviamente attivo questo tipo di attività. Tra l'altro ha trovato via via rispondenza anche in quelle che sono le politiche di Ateneo nell'innovazione didattica, quindi la cosa ci fa molto piacere. Ma lo ringrazio anche nella sua veste di allora come referente del corso di elettronica. Elettronica devo dire che probabilmente è stato il corso di studio che più ha investito in termini di persone, risorse, su questo tipo di iniziativa. Quindi io sono elettronico ovviamente e lo dico con un minimo di, come dire, di orgoglio, ma sono anche convinto che quello che abbiamo cercato di fare, continueremo a cercare di fare nei prossimi anni, sia un'opportunità importante per voi studenti per provare a mettervi alla prova. E quindi quello che è successo, e penso che magari poi ci dite anche voi che cosa ne pensate, sia la possibilità di svolgere su due corsi importanti, sul quale questo workshop è articolato, vi siete messi in qualche modo a misurare la validità delle, diciamo, delle competenze che avete acquisito. E quindi in qualche modo io spero che questo sia stato un interessante esercizio di messa a fuoco di quelle che sono le vostre ovviamente competenze e capacità che sicuramente poi da qui in poi voi utilizzerete nella vostra professione. Quindi davvero grazie poi a tutti quelli che hanno ovviamente contribuito in prima persona al buon esito di tutte queste attività, ma sono davvero contento di essere qui oggi. Grazie.
Allora, allora dico una parola, le altre le ha già dette praticamente tu, meglio di come le avrei dette io. Diciamo che, visto che stiamo parlando di ringraziamenti, penso che il ringraziamento più grande debba essere fatto per il professor Piccinini, perché tutto è nato da un'idea soprattutto sua, quando era lui coordinatore, qui ho semplicemente preso il testimone. E voglio dire, ho cercato di fare la mia parte per quanto riguarda appunto l'elettronica. Beh, ovviamente questo vale per 10.000 altre cose rispetto a quello che viviamo tutti i giorni. Sarebbe stato bello farlo come gli anni scorsi nella sala riunioni del dipartimento, tutto insieme dava un po' più l'impressione di collegialità. Siamo obbligati ancora, si spera non per troppo, a farlo in modalità virtuale, ma questo evento è un evento che, oltre a essere riassuntivo di tutte le attività che avete fatto, è anche un modo per rendere anche disponibile verso l'esterno le informazioni relative alle attività che facciamo nell'ambito della quella che adesso è di moda chiamarla didattica innovativa. E infatti, da questo punto di vista, vorrei anche ringraziare tutti i componenti dell'IEEE Student Branch che hanno permesso di fare questo evento live con YouTube e tutte queste cose da giovani che invece ci sono fondamentali. Questo workshop interdisciplinare è un momento, secondo me, estremamente formativo perché è uno dei pochi momenti, cercheremo di aumentarlo in futuro compatibilmente con tutti i limiti, in cui si fanno veramente dei progetti interdisciplinari. Uno dei, diciamo, dei punti da migliorare nell'organizzazione della didattica e il non lavorare a compartimenti stagni. E questo workshop, secondo me, è un esempio, di successo di come si possono mettere insieme competenze che avete acquisito in vari, corsi insieme in un progetto che consideri tutto dalla concezione ad alto livello, a livello architetturale, al progetto fisico, alla scelta della tecnologia, al capire quale sarà la tecnologia del domani per riuscire a realizzare al meglio queste cose. Quindi mi associo anch'io ai complimenti e ai ringraziamenti per gli studenti che hanno partecipato, ma anche e soprattutto spero che poi la professoressa Graziano dica qualcosa al lavoro che è stato fatto dai colleghi, dai dottorandi, assegnisti, di tutto di più, perché magari non si vede tanto, ma in realtà c'è un lavoro molto, molto grande, nella maggior parte dei casi, ahimè, volontaristico, da parte di chi vi ha seguiti in questi mesi, in questa preparazione. Penso che appunto ci vada un ringraziamento enorme anche a lui. Dopodiché direi che mi taccio e sono pronto ad ascoltare le presentazioni. Grazie a tutti.
Bene, allora io faccio
Prego,
che intervenire dato che mi hai chiamata in causa ed era mia precisa intenzione proprio ringraziare tutti gli studenti di dottorato che hanno contribuito quest'anno e anche negli anni precedenti alla buona riuscita di questo tipo di attività, che richiede comunque una capacità di coordinamento e richiede anche la necessità di avere delle competenze varie su vari settori. E non è facile poi far tornare tutto, perché comunque perché il progetto abbia successo deve poi funzionare in qualche modo, no? Non è solo un progettino di un corso dove più o meno le cose basta che vengano, devono funzionare anche nell'intero organigramma e anche tra gruppi ci deve essere una coerenza. E questo lavoro è stato reso utile veramente dall'interesse e dall'entusiasmo di tanti dottorandi che in questa edizione voglio nominare, sono stati prima di tutto Luca Agnoli, Yuri Ardesi, Andrea Coluccio, Chiara Elfi Spano, Fabrizio Moggio della Beretta e Marco Vacca, che ha contribuito anche lui. E mi piace anche ricordare quelli degli anni passati, perché magari non abbiamo fatto una cosa così diffusa, ma era più localizzata e internos, e che comunque nel tempo si sono anche passati la palla. In questo però voglio anche dire che per noi è stata una crescita, è stata oggettivamente una crescita anche nella capacità di organizzare una cosa di questo genere, difficile a volte, un po' complicata, però è stato necessario organizzarci tra di noi, coordinarci, e credo che sia stata una crescita anche per i dottorandi che hanno contribuito a questa attività. E a questo punto vorrei anche sottolineare un altro valore aggiunto del workshop per gli studenti che partecipano, e cioè il fatto di dover lavorare in gruppo in modo efficace, che è di nuovo una di quelle competenze non dette, che però sono fondamentali, che sicuramente difficilmente si sviluppano tanto nei corsi normali, ecco, nei progetti dei corsi normali. E quindi vi ringrazio per aver messo in piedi tutto questo macchinario, mi riferisco proprio a Maurizio e Gianluca, perché comunque ha fatto sì che anche noi mettessimo in piedi dei meccanismi laterali ma fondamentali, che sono poi alla base di tutto il lavoro di gruppo che si fa in un team anche in azienda. E quindi grazie, grazie a tutti, e direi un grossissimo in bocca al lupo ai ragazzi che adesso andranno a parlare, non togliamogli tempo. Grazie, e grazie a Yuri per fare da Cicerone, grazie.
Ok, grazie professor Piccinini, professor Zamboni, professoressa Graziano. Direi che a questo punto possiamo passare direttamente al primo gruppo, quindi darei la parola a Alessandro Barrera, Wei Kai Liu e Paolo Cacciatore.
Ok. So, good evening and welcome. I'm Alessandro Barrera. I'm the first presenter for the Group 1, which designed a high-speed and low-power ALU. In order to achieve our goal, we needed to define some cost functions to understand what design choices we should take. The first and main cost function we defined was the power delay product. Also, power delay error product was considered as a secondary cost function. In the first part, we design an integer addition and multiplication unit. Then the same operations are designed in floating point units. And at the end, some auxiliary operators completed the ALU. For each of these units, the same design flow is followed. The VHDL design, which was either directly in VHDL or exploiting a Python script as code generator. Then the testing phase, once the unit were working, the synthesis phase, and then tested again, and the complete ALU was assembled and placed en route to complete the design flow. In the testing phase, a set of Python scripts were exploited, and the simulation tool ModelSim in such a way that we could use a reference model in Python or VHDL again in order to validate the UT. Let's start from the first unit, which is the LModder. But before we dive in, why the LModder? Well, the through our reference papers, showed us the Almadur had the best power delay product than the most common others, such as, and also the parallel prefix other brand Kung. Also, it has the power delay area product better than the Ladner Fischer and Kolbe Stone. So the ALMA algorithm is a binary tree parallel prefix adder of simple processors which computes the sum in just one pass of the tree. Here, an 8-bit ALMA adder is shown in its binary tree representation. In particular, we can see that the sum bits are computed in an exponential fashion, exploiting the leaf node that computes the generate and propagate bits. And from now on, all the generic nodes computes the same operations, computing the partial sums, propagate, group propagate, group generate bits. In order to do this, each of these operations is performed by these simple processors, which are just defined by a few logic gates. The same hierarchy is exploited in the VHDL design, in which we described the ALMADER in its binary tree form, exploiting some of the VHDL features. Here we can see the post-synthesis results that we had of the ALMADER compared to a behavioral adder with no constraints, just to have some sort of baseline to compare it with. In particular, we can see that the ALMADER had a good slow a delay and a good power delay product, even though the power delay area product was not as good. Some variations of the ALM were also explored. In particular, we designed an architecture which could include a carry-in bit, which led to another subtractor unit, which was included in the final ALU, and also an incrementer was designed, which was exploited in a 2's complement. In particular, the incrementer was designed by simplifying the nodes by knowing one of the operands. In particular, we defined the negate leaf node, and the other leaves were actually made no logic. And so the simplification moved on onto the propagated nodes and to what we call the side nodes, which are just a slightly modified version of the generic node in the ALMADER. Here we can see the proposed ALM with the simplification used within a 2's complement and compared to another 2's complement using a completely standard ALM. Here we can see that all the different characteristics were improved, in particular the power delay and power delay area product. Moving on to the multiplier, we had our design choice fall to the reduced complexity Wallace, which has two main differences with the standard Wallace, which are the triangular, the matrix, the dot matrix of the partial products is organized in a triangular shape, and the alpha adders are not used unless this would lead to an additional reduction stage as predicted from this expression. The main design choices were to have a generic n-bit implementation in order to exploit this design also in other places, for example, in the floating point unit, with a 53-bit multiplier, and also we exploited a Python script as code generator. Also, two versions of these were developed, one with a ripple carry adder, one with an ALM adder. These two were then compared to a Bugwali multiplier, which was used as a starting architecture. Here we can see the comparison among all of these three multiplier architectures, and we can see that as the ALM, made possible to exploit the RCW advantages. Now I'm going to leave the word to my colleague and friend Huikai Liu.
Good evening, and thank you, Alessandro, for the introduction. And now we are going to talk about the floating point unit. Sorry, Alessandro, the presentation is stopped. Okay. So let's start with the multiplier. We can notice that the critical path of this circuit is due to the integral multiplier. So in order to reach the high speed and low power aim, the multiplier with best trade-off is needed, while for the other operations, low power components are enough. And the logic, the control unit is composed by several comparators and logic gates, and the flags produced are used in order to select the correct result, because we would have overflow, underflow, and we have to normalize the result. Further optimizations can be reached by simplifying the generic blocks, such as this adder, this one, and the comparator inside the control unit. For example, here we have a simple circuit that corresponds to two comparators, and it tells us if the number belongs to the range 1024 and 3069. After proving the correct behavior of the multiplier, several versions have been synthesized, and it's possible to appreciate how the performances improve by using a high speed and low power multiplier and by using ad hoc components. The version with the pipeline techniques gives a larger power delay product, and therefore there will be no a pipeline stage in the multiplier. Then we have the floating point adder, and in order to optimize this component, we use an efficient fixed point adder, which is the ELM, both for the computation of the exponent difference and for the mantissa. Then logarithmic shifters are used here and here. And in order to perform the normalization, an optimized leading zero counter is needed to shift the result and to update the exponent. After proving the correct behavior of the adder, it has been synthesized with Synopsys. Also in this case, different version have been considered, and the best one is where the pipeline and the clock gating techniques are applied. Finally, the complete ALU is obtained, including all the operators in one single top level entity, this one, and it has two inputs, an opcode, the output, and an overflow bit. As internal blocks of the ALU, aside the four components described in now, also some useful but simple blocks are inserted, such as a shifter, leading zero counter, and a block that performs the choose complement operation. And in order to validate the presented work, three Python scripts are used. And this last script is used to compare the output generated by the simulation of the ALU with the one generated at Python model. And it also reads the input file in order to retrieve and specify the operation that was performed when an error occurred. After that, the circuit has been synthesized several times on Synopsys by applying different clock period constraints. Because we have the aim to find out the minimum power delay product. And so the PDP and the PDAP have been computed. So in this graphic, we can see that the best version of the ALU is the one obtained with the clock gating technique. And this version is chosen for the place and route analysis. Finally, here we have a summary of all the results obtained for the different components. And that's all for this part. Now I'm going to leave the word to my friend and colleague, Paolo Cacciatore.
Thank you, Ricai. I requested control, yes. So for the second part, our aim was to study how changing the technology greatly affected performance and could lead to major improvements. We first studied the 45 nanometer planar MOS technology that was the one used automatically in libraries for Synopsys and in Novus for part one, and then studied a cutting edge technology with the FinFET morphology and saw if there were any improvements. The work has been done all with using Cadence Virtuoso. So all the tests and the schematic drawings were done with that software. The first step was to retrieve the fundamental parameters of the single transistor performances for the 45 nanometer planar MOS. So we found on and off state currents, as well as the threshold voltages and the subthreshold slope. Then we analyzed the static characteristics and the dynamic performance of a minimum inverter, analyzing its noise margins and the fanout of four delay, which is the most used one to compare different technologies. And then manually built scaled down versions of the circuits we implemented in part one again using Virtuoso. So we have an 8-bit L-Mother and a 4-bit reduced complexity Wallace multiplier. Here we can see that we started from the most basic cells and then worked our way up using a hierarchical design approach. And then we performed DC tests to validate the design and check that the circuits worked properly. So we can have here two DC sweeps that test two combinations for each circuit, and the results are correct. So when analyzing the FinFET model, we know that the philosophy behind it is the fact is surrounding the channel with the MOS structure on its three sides in order to improve the ion over IOF ratio. And this greatly lowers short channel effects and also quantum mechanical effects. So the FinFET offer more scaling headroom compared to planar MOS. The model used is the BCMCMG that is currently the industry standard. And the parameters were the SOI wafer and then 40 nanometer gate length and a fin that was 7 nanometer thick, 30 nanometer high, with a mid-gap material as a metal in the gate stack. So the same work function was set for both P and N transistor. So we then proceeded finding the same values that we found for the 45 nanometer planar MOS for both the single transistor parameters and then the inverter parameters. And we found that if we wanted to do a comparison, we found an off-state current that is 5 orders of magnitude lower thanks to the higher threshold and almost ideal subthreshold slope, as well as higher margins for the inverter and a speed up in the fanout of 4 of 2.6 times. We then repeated the tests for more complex circuits, now using transient analysis and V-pulse generators, testing the same input combinations. So to find the speed up when changing technology. And we found that the speed up for both the adder and the multiplier was of roughly 3 times. We go here from 72 picoseconds to 24 for the adder. And the same thing goes for the multiplier when we go from 188 picoseconds to 64. So a speed up that is almost equal to the fanout of 4. It is at least comparable to this value. We then proceeded to furtherly optimize our model, experimenting with the work functions of the N and P transistors. We wanted to lower the threshold because it was at about half of the power supply voltage. And we obtained a speed up in the fanout of 4 with 1 volt of VDD of around 50%. And if we wanted to take a more low power approach, we could exploit the lowering the threshold to lower the power supply voltage to 500 millivolts. So to have a circuit that was only 10% slower, but draw 23% of the active power. So this is ignoring the static power that is now way higher because of the higher off-state current. Those are all the acknowledgments, the references we used for our work. And i ringraziamenti li faccio in italiano. Volevamo ringraziare tutti i professori, dottori e dottorandi per questa incredibile opportunità. E volevo ringraziare anche i miei compagni Alessandro e Wikai, con cui abbiamo stretto un rapporto che va oltre l'essere colleghi, ovviamente, perché dopo un anno di lavoro non abbiamo fatto solo un ALU, abbiamo fatto anche delle amicizie. E volevamo commentare molto positivamente l'attività di workshop, in quanto avere così tanta autonomia poteva essere inizialmente disorientante, e però poi ha portato a moltissime soddisfazioni nel realizzare qualcosa che è sicuramente unico e personale per quanto ci riguarda. Grazie a tutti per l'opportunità e cedo la parola.
Grazie mille e grazie anche per questi ultimi commenti. Allora, un piccolo reminder per chi sta guardando l'evento da YouTube: se volete fare delle domande potete scrivere direttamente nella chat e le faccio io per voi. Mentre chi è all'interno di questa call può fare direttamente le domande intervenendo o scrivendomele. Allora, I switch to English because I already have two questions. The first one is, what are the reasons why you use the Python script to generate an n-size Wallace component instead of generic VHDL component?
I think I can answer that. It was just because the complexity of the Wallace. In particular, we exploited I don't know if I can show the slide back again.
Yes. But,
in our case, we wanted to make it as general as possible. So we had this Python script in which just a variable was set to a certain number, 64 or 53, and it will just automatically have its if cases and makes it more as simple as possible. It was just merely a comfort, if you want, reason. Also because of the expression here, I didn't waste much time talking about it, but we have this this relation here, which tells us how much how many maximum rows should be in each stage. So this devaluation of this variable and comparing it to a prediction of what using only full adders would give us, it's a bit tricky to do that in VHDL. In Python, it's very easy.
Okay.
I hope that answers.
Yeah, thank you very much. For the second question, at some point you discussed some multiplicators. What is the parallelism of the comparison?
Yeah, they're all in 64 bits. I think it is talking about this one. They're talking about this one. Every comparison is done in 64 bits architectures.
Okay. Another question. Did you analyze the power consumption of the 45 nanometer technology?
Is he referring to the second part or the first part of the workshop?
For the second part.
Yes. No, for the second part of the workshop, we did not measure any power because it was very difficult to determine manually the number of transistors. So as this was not using an automatic synthesis software, it was very hard to quantize their values. So we just considered on and off states currents for a single transistor to evaluate a realistic quantity for static and active power.
Okay. Maybe there is someone in the call that wants to pose any question.
Yes, I have a question, yes. If I can. Okay, you talked about the clock gating technique. How did you apply the clock gating technique to your design? I mean, do you develop by hand the clock gating or you inserted it by using Synopsys?
I think I can answer that. We used it in the ALU because in each clock cycle, only two registers at the input are enabled. And so we thought that if we use the clock gating, we can shut down, not shut down, but we can save power by not considering the other registers. And for this, we use the automatic tools of Synopsys. We didn't do it by hand.
One thing that I wanted to add is that we obviously implemented using automatic software tools, but we also checked within the schematic drawn by Synopsys if it was actually implemented, because it needs to interpret the VHDL file to ensure that. So we did check after that.
Okay, thank you. And I have another question. You talked about a pipeline version of your multiplier, if I remember correctly. How much is the degree of pipelining? I mean, where did you insert your pipelining registers? And how much is the degree?
So we try to use the pipeline only in the floating point multiplier, but not more than one stage of pipeline, because the critical component where the integral multiplier. And so in order to improve the performances, we should insert a pipeline inside the integral multiplier and not in the floating point multiplier. And we didn't make this choice because we thought that this ALU will be used in a processor where there are a lot of pipelining stages. And so this will increase the latency overall latency of the processor if we have different operation in each clock cycle.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I still have one question. Did you try to reduce the supply voltage, and why did you stop to 0.5 volt?
Yes, we tried, and we halved for the low threshold variant. And this was because we didn't modify within the 45 nanometer technology, because it was 1 volt of power supply was a standard value. So it was the value present in the library of Synopsys and Innovus. So we wanted to study just the case applicable to our use in part one. And then we explore different solutions for the FinFET, but only for the low threshold case, because the unmodified version had already a threshold voltage of around 500 millivolts. So okay. we decided with a sort of trial and error procedure, the 0.5 volt, because we wanted to ensure that the delay was almost equal to the original one with high threshold.
Okay. Well, I think this is enough for you. Thank you very much for your talk and for answering all the questions.
Thank you.
And I think we can move to the second group, composed by Alessandro Lovesio, Lorenzo Poloni, and Simone Ponte. And they work on power reduction and with TFET technology. So please, guys, it's your turn.
Thank you. Okay. Good afternoon, and welcome to our presentation for the Innovative Systems Workshop. We're the second group, and our focus has been on low power consumption. The goal of the first part of the workshop was to design an arithmetic logic unit with as many functions as possible, but also as low power as possible. We performed as many kinds of optimizations we could make, as we will show next. Being the low power group, we designed the ALU with only the necessary I/O. So we have the operands, the result, a few flags, an opcode to select the operation, and enable for gating and a clock. Internally, we have two units, the integer unit and the floating point unit. The operands are routed to both units, and there is an operation decoder that selects the operation inside the units. The output multiplexers are controlled by the units themselves that signal when new data is ready, and the last valid output is kept fixed on the outside by this circuit here to reduce the switching activity on the output bus. About the operations we implemented, we have addition, subtraction, and multiplication for both units, and also shift and bitwise operations. A few more details on the floating point implementation. We used the IEEE 754 format. As rounding, we chose truncation to avoid the rounding circuits. And we also decided to consider the normal numbers as zero, also to save power at the cost of a slightly reduced range. About the validation process, we created an input generator that creates input vectors. These are used with the VHDL source files, the test bench files, and the simulation scripts to run the models in simulation, which produces output vectors. These are then checked by the checker that produces a log file with eventual errors and some statistics. Finally, the simulation scripts allow for the simulation of multiple architectures at the same time, so that we can perform multiple tests in the same run. Now a few implementation details. For the adder, we implemented many types, but we found out, kind of as expected, that the Brent-Kung consumes the least power. So we used it both for the integer unit and the floating point unit. We did the same process for the multiplier, where we found out about that the Bovule was the best one for signed multiplication, so we used it for the integer unit. On the other hand, the Wallace tree was the best one for unsigned multiplication, so we used it for the floating point multiplier. Here there are a few slides on the floating point operations. There is the multiplier, as you can see, even if only the absolutely necessary things are left, it is still quite complex. And expensive, and the same can be said about the adder, as you can see here. Now we can talk about the optimizations that we performed. They can be divided in architectural, algebraic transformations, pipelining, clock gating, and power gating. And we can now see some examples. For the architectural simplifications, we can see that for the integer multiplication, only half of the output bits are needed. So we created an overflow detector that allows us to cut in half the multiplier complexity, thus reducing the power consumption even by 53%. For the transformations, we can see here in a piece of the floating point adder that by changing a bit the order of the operations, we can move the sign inversion block and join it to the adder that comes next, reducing the complexity. And this can lead to an up to 10% reduction in power consumption for this unit. We also implemented pipelining in the floating point unit, as it allows for reduced glitching, finer grain clock gating, and also, of course, for voltage scaling. And regarding clock gating, we have it on all the registers, and it's based on the enable signal coming from the operation decoder. But in the floating point unit, such as in this case, there can be possibilities for more advanced gating. As you can see this example, we duplicated the registers and used the selector as a condition, as an additional condition. And while this increased the amount of logic, it allows for an up to 15% reduction in power consumption in this case. Finally, we also tried to implement power gating so that with UPF, so that one of the units or the whole arithmetic logic unit, but the power controller could be shut down. Unfortunately, the open 45 nanometer library didn't support the power gating blocks, so we couldn't actually test it, but it was still very promising.
All right. So now that we wrote our VHDL model and simulated it, we can move on to the synthesis and the physical design. So these are the five main steps that we followed, and now I will try to explain them one by one. The first one is the back annotation process. As you can see from this diagram, the synthesizer and the simulator exchange files, such as delay files and also switching activities, to generate a power report which is accurate and realistic. This process is fully automated, so we wrote some scripts, such as the first one that compiles the design, the second one that simulates it, and the third one that generates the power report. So here we can see some of the results from the power analysis. As for the integer unit, we can see that the best multiplier is the optimized Bovule, while for the others, the Brent-Kung consumes the least amount of power. Instead, for the floating point unit, the best architectures are the ones that are not pipelined. In this table, you can see that these are the architectures we chose to compose the final ALU. As you can see here, we chose the pipeline versions for the floating point unit, although they are not they consume more because we can apply voltage scaling to them. Here, there are some statistics from after synthesis. We see here that the final power is high, but is still 45% less compared to the initial version. And also here, the main power contribution is the leakage power, and the floating point unit is the one that dissipates more power. So the value you saw before can be further reduced by applying voltage scaling. We did some calculation and we estimated that power can be reduced by approximately 60%. And this is thanks to pipeline. Then we moved on to the physical design using the Innovus tool and the 45 nanometers technology library. Here we can see a comparison between the ALU before and after the place and route. And here the leakage power is no longer the main contribution. And also the total power consumption has more than doubled than before. This happens because now interconnections are present and they use more realistic models. And so these capacitances increase dynamic power and in turn, the total power. In this slide, though, we can see what we could have done, but we what didn't. And this, for the UPF is the most important one for our group as we are the low power group. In the second part, we implemented a defect library, but first of all, we had to create a 45 nanometers library as a reference. These are the four main steps we followed to implement both libraries, but we encountered some problems. The first one is that the building complex cells takes time, so we didn't assemble the complete ALU, but also but only a simple version on the floating point multiplier. And also, since the verification could not be automated, we only tested some of the inputs and not all of them. On a positive note, the hierarchical approach was very useful, as you can see from this example in this cell. Without the hierarchy, this picture would have been much more complicated and unreadable. The test bench was performed using a voltage source as inputs and also strength one inverters as loads. The power was estimated using the calculator tool from Virtuoso. Here's an example of a test bench of the Brenton model. So the power analysis was performed along with the test bench. So first of all, we tested the simple cells, which had 2 to 3 inputs. So we were actually able to test all the possible combinations. And here we see that the inverter consumes the least amount of power, while the full adder is the one that consumes the most. And then we moved on to the more complex cells. As I said, this could not be tested thoroughly, but so these power figures might not be realistic, but still we can see here that the power in general is higher than before. And this is probably because the cells were built following a VHDL model, which is fully structural. So an optimization were performed by compiler. Thank you.
The last part of this workshop after the implementation of the reference library was the implementation of the TFET library. Before starting, what is a TFET? A TFET is a tunnel field effect transistor. So a transistor that uses the tunneling process as a current conduction mechanism. In this way, we can lower the subthreshold slope and so the IOF current and the static power. However, we lower also the ion current and so the performances. We started our analysis considering the static behavior of the transistor, so of the NTFET and PTFET, to find the values of ion and subthreshold slope. Then we passed to the dynamic behavior of the transistor, and we saw the first problem of these technologies. In particular, we saw that after the second transition, we have the output voltage that is fixed at a negative level. This is due to multiple reasons. In particular, after the spikes, the transistor changes the working regions, and also the presence of big parasitic capacitance that are also amplified by the Miller effect in case of a consecutive stages doesn't help. To conclude the analysis, we use also parametric analysis to see and we saw that an increase of transistor width bring an increase also of current as expected, while the temperature has only a negligible effect on the current. Next, we pass to the inverter analysis.
And here it's reported only the dynamic behavior where we can notice the presence of Miller effect in case of consecutive stages, so of FO1 or FO4 loads. For the inverter, we saw also the dependence of the power and delays for the dimension. When we increase the dimension, we have an increase of the power consumption, a linear increase, and an hyperbolic decrease of delays. This is due to the fact that we have an increase of ion current, but also of capacitance. Then we pass to the balancing of the simple gates, and we found that the PTFET and NTFET behaves in a similar way. So we can use the same dimension for them. However, if we have stacked transistor, we need to increase their dimension. In particular, it was experimentally found that we need 1.4 times the dimension of the unstacked transistor in case of 2-stacked transistor, and 1.8 times the dimension in case of 3-stacked transistor. The last thing was the analysis of the output signals, where we can find again the problems related to the negative voltages. This is connected to the problems that we found for the NTFET dynamic behavior. And we saw also that this problem is limited in case of transition of the signals. So we decided to implement some output buffers that are formed by two consecutive inverters. These inverters can force two consecutive transition of the signal and try to improve the signals. However, they are not always efficient, and sometimes a specific analysis must be carried on for complex circuit. Finally, we could obtain the value of power for the TFET and compare them with the CMOS technology. We found that all for basic cell, we have already a big reduction that is always greater than 30%. And this reduction grows when we move to more complex cells, where we can surpass, when we can overcome the 80%, in particular for the multiplier, we are around 85%. The last thing that we have done in these last weeks was to analyze another structure for the TFET, not only the standard one. And we saw that it's better for both power consumption and delays. However, it has some problems related to the noise margin. What could be done? We could certainly create more complex cells or sequential cells. We could do more detailed characterization. We could do we could search the optimal TFET sites. This is done only in some specific case. And we could also test different TFET structure to find the best one. I ringraziamenti di nuovo li faccio in italiano perché mi sembra giusto ringraziare sia i miei colleghi, sia i professori e tutti i dottorandi che ci hanno permesso di partecipare a questo workshop. Abbiamo imparato veramente tanto in questi ultimi 12 mesi, nell'anno passato, sia dal punto di vista tecnologico e pratico, quindi usare i tool o comunque conoscenze pratiche, sia dal punto di vista delle soft key skills, perché comunque lavorare in gruppo, il lavoro di gruppo è sicuramente migliorato, lavorare in gruppo a distanza è sicuramente un nuovo aspetto del lavoro di gruppo che abbiamo esplorato benissimo in quest'anno. Quindi vogliamo ringraziare tutti per averci dato questa possibilità dove abbiamo potuto fare scelte e esplorare nuove strade che a volte erano giuste, a volte erano sbagliate, ma ci hanno portato sempre ad un insegnamento. Quindi siamo molto contenti di averne fatto parte e grazie a tutti.
Grazie.
Grazie.
Grazie a voi. Allora, abbiamo già un po' di domande. So again, I switched to English. Sometimes you mention maximum frequency. How did you determine the maximum frequency of such circuits?
Maybe you can answer. Basically, we just synthesized the circuit and we try to synthesize with multiple clock frequency to search for, because of course, the synthesizer tries to adapt to the target frequency. So we tried multiple frequencies and also to look for the power changes with different clocks. But basically we synthesized the circuit and then with the tool we got the critical path delay. So just okay. That.
Thank you. Then slide number 44, sorry. How did you estimate the 60% reduction of power?
I think that it's talking about the voltage scaling because. Okay.
Sure. Yeah.
We used a library that doesn't support voltage domains, so we did it only using MATLAB or other tools, and we use some formulas that here is not reported but are known for this topic, and we saw that reducing the voltage, the voltage supply, we can reduce also power, obviously. To have a limit of reduction, we fixed the maximum delays equal to the worst case delay of our operator. So each operator has the same delays, but uses different voltage supplies. In this way, for the total ALU, we could reach a reduction that is about 60%. And so we have different voltages domains for different operators because we have faster operators that needs that can work with a lower voltage supply.
Okay. Then slide 67. Can you give some comments about these behaviors? Do you have any idea on why this tendency?
This one?
Yeah.
Which one?
Both, I think.
Okay. Temperature is stays pretty much, let's say, the same while changing the temperature, simply because the working mechanism of the TFETs is not the thermal emission, so the tunneling effect is still a bit dependent on temperature. As you can see, it's not perfectly constant, but its dependence is really reduced. While changing the width, it's pretty linear. Of course, in this slide, it's the graph is logarithmic, so it's kind of confusing, but. The changing width for the TFETs is very standard, like the normal transistors, really.
Okay, thank you very much. I still have one question from YouTube, and I would ask the people in the call if they have questions. A question for the low power group. Did you try to investigate approximate arithmetic circuits? If yes, did you observe a further power reduction?
I can speak a bit about the thing because I did it. The part where on the floating point circuits, we kind of did that as we don't support the
normals,
the normal numbers, and also the rounding method is a truncation. Of course, they are not there are things that. I used also on not on this kind of circuit, which is very low power. Also, normal circuits sometimes use these simplifications, but we chose to do that most importantly. We didn't do many other things like this because for an ALU that is. Supposed to be kind of generic. I mean, we don't know where it is going to be used. So using approximate solutions can be very good, but mostly if you know what calculation you're going to do. As we don't know that, it's very hard to optimize in this way, as we might introduce some errors that for some application can be really too large and can make the circuit useless. So that's the main reason.
Okay. So I see we are running out of time. Is there any question from other people in the call?
Otherwise, I have a question, okay. Actually. Okay, thank you for your presentation. I have a question about the power gating technique that you applied. Can you give some additional details to the UPF procedure? That is very, very interesting procedure.
Uh, Alessandro.
Hello. kind of all the questions are things that I did the most. Sorry for the other two, but I'm going to ask that these two. About the power gating, if it's one of the most hot topic, let's say about like this, about power reduction. And but unfortunately, we couldn't use it because the blocks like the switches for the for cutting off the power supplies and the isolators were not present in the library, so we couldn't test if the actual reductions. But we did implement it in UPF. We did the sort of script, let's call it. And this picture here is basically what the synthesizer wanted to build before actually building it in the library with the library. So basically what we designed is power switches that cut off the supply voltage. The ground is not cut, and the isolators on all the output on all the outputs of the blocks, so to not disrupt what could come after the ALU. It's kind of a very simple implementation, very basic. But after we did this, we found out that it wouldn't work. We couldn't test it, so we just stopped here.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much for your talk and for answering all the questions. I think we are a bit late, so maybe I would move to the last group. Thank you very much, guys. So the last group, composed by Luca Norisso, Gabriele Perron, and Deborah Volpe, and they work on in the frequency domain. So they try to increase as much as possible the maximum frequency of the device. Please, it's your turn.
Yes, just one minute. Okay, we're ready.
Good afternoon, I'm Luca Norisso.
I'm Gabriele Perrone.
I'm Deborah Volpe.
We are the high-speed group of the workshop. The main target of the workshop was to obtain an integer ALU and a floating point unit, in our case, optimized from the point of view of frequency. We started, therefore, from the analysis of the different possible architecture for the various operations chosen. Then we tried to improve the solution found to increase the frequency as much as possible. In the second phase, after selecting one operator, we move on to the implementation and comparison with two different technologies. Bulk CMOS 45 nanometer and GAFET. In the first phase of the workshop, we start with the logical design, understood as implementation and simulation of the various operators. First of all, a behavioral version of each operator has been implemented to verify its functioning, and later, one or more optimized versions were derived. We compare the performance of the different syntheses and quantify the improvements. As far as the YALU concern, the six operation has been implemented. Addition, subtraction, left and right shift, multiplication, division, and square root. We have assumed to work on two components number, and for each operation, the basic parallelism is 32 bit. This slide presents the architecture of the adder. It was decided to implement a Cobstone adder. In the table, all the optimization levels are shown. First, we try to insert the structure of the Cobstone within a carry select architecture, modifying the parallelism of the internal block in each different implementation. But mixing the carry select structure with the Cobstone adder leads to low performance with respect to a fully 32-bit Cobstone adder. Finally, the pipeline was also applied. For the subtractor, the two complement subtraction was implemented.
In this slide is presented the architecture used for the multiplier. It relies on a particular technique of doing multiplication by splitting operands in halves recursively. In fact, this structure is replicated with half width in the upper blocks, multiplier 16 by 16. The optimization here regarded the best choice of the adder at each level. Pipeline registers were inserted among the operators to finally speed up the whole architecture. In this slide is presented the architecture used for the divider. Here is presented the 4-bit version. We implemented a 32-bit one. The architecture is quite regular, divided in layers. Since on each row, there is a signal propagating through each block, the optimization was performed on each row, exploiting the carry selection technique. At the end, a pipe level for each row was inserted to speed up the whole architecture.
A poorly combinatorial implementation of the no-restoring algorithm was chosen for the roof. In case of negative input, an invalid signal is set to 1, because only integer number was considered. We started with a generic implementation for the number of bits. Design by contraction and the same kind of row optimization used in the divider were employed. In particular, by leaving the generic implementation, it was possible to further optimize by varying the size of the blocks defined in each row. The pipeline was also applied. The structure shown in the picture was used for the barrel shifters. This was implemented generic for the number of bits. It was possible to verify that in this case, applying the pipeline technique does not bring benefits, because the overhead introduced by the insertion of the register is comparable to the current delay and greater than the delay of a single multiplexer. For the floating point unit, it was decided to implement an additional subtraction and multiplication operation for single precision input with the IEEE 754 standard. In this slide, the block diagram used for the implementation of the floating point adder is presented. In the first version, basic configuration, the operation of the various blocks has been described behaviorally in order to leave the synthesizer free to choose an implementation between the available. Subsequently, to each block relating to addition and subtraction, the relative adder subtractor explained previously has been replaced with a suitable parallelism. The left and the right barrel shifters has been also replaced with those explained before. The pipeline version, on the other hand, was obtained by inserting 6 stages of pipe, trying to equally divide the combinatorial delay of the overall structure. A standard architecture was considered for the floating point multiplier. In this case, the slowest element that actually defined the overall delay of the structure is the 24 bits multiplier. The first evaluation of the delay was made with the classical multiplier with a matrix structure, which was then replaced with the multiplier used in the integer ALU, appropriately scaled for the number of bits required. The pipeline was then applied.
For the integer ALU, the implementations of each operator with the most compatible delays were then chosen in order to obtain the best possible frequency without wasting resources. The synthesis enhancement commands have also been exploited for optimization from the point of view of frequency, reaching a final frequency of 909 MHz. In this case, we will have slower operations, such as the square root or the division, with different levels of pipes. Similarly, for the FPU, implementations with comparable delays were chosen, and also in this case, the synthesis enhancement commands were exploited, reaching a frequency of 384 MHz. With operator without pipe levels. We then moved on to the study of technologies. Since our target is the frequency, the two technologies we compared were the 45 nanometer CMOS technology and the GAFET technology, which, thanks to its good channel control and high current density, can guarantee an improvement in terms of delays. We followed the illustrated chain. First, we characterize the N and P transistors. Then we build up the necessary gates for our chosen operator, comparing them with the different technologies. After that, we implemented the basic blocks starting from the gates. Finally, we put them together to have the final operator in different parallelisms. The operator that we have chosen to implement is the Coxton adder. First of all, we rescaled the architecture from 32 bits to 2 bits. After analyzing the 2 bits implementation, we increase the parallelism gradually up to 8 bits to analyze and obtain a qualitative trend of the frequency reduction as the number of bits increases.
First, we characterize the P and N gate-all-around FET obtained from the provided model. We considered three wires for each transistor as basic strength. Some design parameters of the base model were then modified to obtain transistor optimized for high speed. The ion, IOF, threshold voltage, and subthreshold slope of the N gate-around FET were evaluated. And of the P gate-around FET, comparing them with those of the 45 nanometer technology. The model provided to us originally had a threshold voltage approximately equal to half of the supply voltage, and therefore it was an LSTP device, and therefore optimized for the power rather than frequency. By acting on a parameter, it was possible to obtain a supply voltage threshold voltage ratio equal to about 3, and thus obtain a device of the LOP type, and therefore optimized for the frequency, as can be seen from the graph. The threshold voltage is given by the position of the peak of the second derivative of the drain source current as a function of the gate source voltage. From this image, it's possible to compare the ion and enforced instance the threshold voltage of the 45 nanometer technologies at the gate all around FET for N and for P transistors. It is also possible to notice how the subthreshold slope of the gate around FET is closer to ideally than that of the CMOS standard, thanks to the good control of the channel. This means lower IOF and therefore lower static power consumption.
The first gate we characterized was the inverter. In this slide, we wanted to show the comparison of this gate before and after the GAFET optimizations described before. Taking the simplest gate, with this comparison, we wanted to see how the optimizations performed on single transistors can affect the gate. The most important thing to notice is a reduction of about 100 millivolts in the noise margin levels. This slide instead shows the propagation times comparison for the three analyzed cases, bulk 45 nanometer, GAFET unoptimized, and GAFET optimized. In this case, we can see that already the unoptimized GAFET technology results faster with respect to 45 nanometer. Optimizations contribute to improve the result. Here we wanted to show the same comparison for the AND gate, confronting propagation delays for all the inputs. On an equal gates layout, we can say that in this case, the optimization on GAFET were necessary in order to have a faster gate with respect to 45 nanometer technology. For a dimensioning issue, we saw that XOR gate layout was optimized for bulk technology. We tried to use the same layout for GAFET technology in order to have a coherent comparison. Here we report the results. We can see that in this case, GAFET technology was not able to beat the bulk one, but only to arrive close. This is the last characterized gate, the most complex one. As in the AND gate case, the optimizations were crucial in order to have a significant improvement in terms of speed.
Now we show the results of the analysis performed on the implementation of the adder with different parallels for both 45 nanometer technology and GAFET technology. In the histogram present in this slide, the performance of the 2-bit adders are shown. The measurement condition consists of setting all the bits of the first adder to 1 and all the bits of the second adder to 0, switching the input carry signal. The results for the 45 nanometer technology are shown in blue. Instead, the one for the non-optimized VTH GAFET technology in orange and the one for the optimized GAFET technology in gray. On the horizontal axis are present various propagation delays between the signal edge of the Cin and the different output signal. As you can see, the non-optimized GAFET technology produces worse results than the 45 nanometer, while the optimized GAFET has a propagation delay lower than both other technologies, except in the case of the least significant sound bit. In that case, the 45 nanometer technology turned out to be the best. This is because the speed reduction of the XOR gate. This slide showed the results for 4-bit adders. In this case, the optimized GAFET technology is the best for every type of delay. This is because the improvement of the other gates overcome the loss of the XOR gate. This slide, the results of the 6-bit adder are presented. Due to a large number of outputs, only the worst delay for sum and shout signal are shown. Optimized GAFET technology is the best. This slide shows the results for the 8-bit adders. Again, only the worst delay for SAM and Xiao signal are reported. Also in this case, the optimized GAFET has the best performance. These graphs show an interpolation of the results. The graph on the right is obtained in respect to different input parallelism. Instead, the graph on the left is obtained for different level of the Cogstone adder. The curve in the two graphs are almost the same. As you can see, the performance improvement using GAFET technology become more and more important by increasing the number of bits. From this graph, we can obtain a linear function that provides a frequency upper limit for any parallelism of the adder. This slide presents a summary of the comparison between GAFET and 45 nanometer technology. The focus of our comparison concerns frequency performance. So we can observe that GAFET technology wins by being able to reach higher frequency than 45 nanometer technology. As a secondary effect, we have observed a reduction of the IOF due to the improvement of the electrostatic control on the channel and more ideal subthreshold slope.
We, therefore, thanks to those who follow us and the opportunity that is given to us. Like our operator, we have improved ourselves in this workshop, both as individual and as group.
This was a really good opportunity, I think, to learn by doing, mixing knowledge from different courses.
And we strongly recommend this experience to all the students that want to test themselves. And thanks for your attention. If you have any question, we will be happy to answer.
Okay, thank you very much. So I still have again a few questions. Can you go to slide number 22?
Yes.
Okay, here we see two output pins, T and E. If you can comment these two output pins.
I can answer. T is a temperature pins, but it's included in the model, but it's not necessarily connect these to something. It's for probably additional analysis. The other one called A is the standard bulk connection, and we have also drain source and gate like in a standard case.
Okay. So the second question is related to slide number 24. What is the device you considered in this analysis? How many channels are present for the GAFET?
We consider, as I said, three wires as a standard strength. And we can see that both for N and for P transistor is good for creation of an inverter. We okay. choose three because it's a standard value.
Okay. A general question, how did you characterize the GAFET gates? If you can give some comments on this.
I continue to answer.
We perform the same characterization that we do on 45 nanometer technology. And we follow by only the transistor, we characterize the output by see the IDS current respect to the change of VGS or VDS. Then we characterize the subthreshold slope, and then we start with the characterization of the gates.
We perform the same characterizations for bulk and GAFET, except just for the trans characteristic of the 45 nanometer that was already known. And because we wanted to just to see if the optimizations can lead to DC characteristic not suitable for logic. So in fact, we observed a reduction of 100 millivolt in the noise margin levels that is still compatible for performing operations without errors.
Okay, I have another external question. Then I will leave the floor to other people in the call if they have questions. So which adder was properly employed in the high-speed floating point unit? If you tested different adders, Did you observe significant differences in the delay with the same pipeline and different adders?
Yes, I can answer them. We can go to slides 12. And yeah, the first things that we have to do in the base configuration was to describe the adder only behavior in order to leave the synthesizer free to choose the best type of architecture that it want. Then we use Cogstone adder, as explained previously. And well, the Cogstone was faster respect to the one implemented by the synthesizer in every type of adder, except in one case, in the exponent difference, where inside is hide another, the version implemented by the synthesizer was faster than the Cogstone due to the fact that the Cogstone works as a better performance with high number of parallelism of bit. In the case of the exponent different, the parallelism of bit was 8. So the synthesizer synthesized something better, but I don't remember the architecture, sorry.
Okay, maybe we still have time for the last question. Is there any question from the call?
Yes, I have a question if I can.
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. I have a question about, of course, your presentation. It seems like that you synthesized and you performed the physical design on two separate entities, so the integer ALU and the floating point ALU. Why did you choose to separate these two entities?
Because the difference in frequency of the IALU and the floating point unit was too much. So to not slow down the integer ALU, we choose to keep separate the two units. I don't know.
Also in addition, because the quantity of area in our architecture is very high, and so it's better separate the two entity. Because improving our system for high speed, it's necessary duplicate the hardware many times, and so the quantity of area required is very high.
So your ALU will consist on two separate entities and two separate chips. Is it correct?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. We still have the last question. What were the loads at which the gates based on Gafet were tested? Did you try to verify the limit at which the performance were not acceptable anymore and required in case buffer insertions?
Yeah, we used the standard FO4 load, so four inverter for each output pin, each inverter loaded with a standard capacitor. We didn't test the maximum load for each pin, but when mixing with the model, there was a parameter regarding the total area of the drain and source that basically is a parameter that considers the total capacitance of drain and source. We didn't know at initial that parameter, but we saw that with the too high values, to non-realistic value, the capacitance is too high that the model breaks and didn't work anymore. So there is a limit. We didn't test it. We didn't have time to test the effective limit, but we know that there is.
Okay. Vedo che non ci sono più domande. Di conseguenza vi ringrazio.
Grazie.
Sia per il talk, sia per aver risposto a tutte queste grazie. Domande. Grazie a voi. E chiederei a questo punto di accendere le webcam a tutti i ragazzi, a chi vuole all'interno della call. Ne approfitto per ringraziare di nuovo tutti quanti, sia le persone che hanno fatto i talk oggi, gli studenti, ma anche tutte le persone che hanno lavorato a questo workshop e le persone che hanno assistito a questo workshop. Dopodiché lascio la parola direttamente alla professoressa Graziano per la chiusura della presentazione finale. Grazie a tutti.
Grazie Yuri, un grossissimo caloroso applauso a tutti quanti, che è difficile fare in questo modo, però ricevetelo e sentitevelo. Siete stati tutti molto bravi e in modo indiretto via chat vari, e ci siamo detti come sono stati bravi, 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 entusiasti e professional. E quindi bravi, anche questo è stato un momento, credo, costruttivo, no? Il fatto di fare la presentazione, si vede che vi siete anche preparati molto per questo. Non l'avevamo pianificata, l'abbiamo fatto un po' all'ultimo, sapendo di darvi una cosa in più, ma voi avete ancora reagito ancora di più, quindi bellissima questa proattività vostra. Siamo molto orgogliosi e onorati di avervi come studenti. E quindi grazie ancora, grazie a tutti e soprattutto grazie all'IEEE Student Branch, che sta veramente ormai superando ogni aspettativa. E a me è venuto in mente, ho detto, aspetta, chiediamo, risposta immediata. Quindi grazie, 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 grazie a tutti quanti, anche quelli che sono nascosti, che non stanno intervenendo, che sappiamo hanno fatto in realtà molto lavoro. Grazie ancora. E riceverete un certificato di attendance di questo workshop firmato dai professor Piccinini, dal professor Zamboni, con penna d'oca. Arrivederci, grazie.
Grazie mille, arrivederci.
Grazie a voi.
Grazie, grazie a voi.
Arrivederci, grazie.
Grazie a tutti.
Grazie.
Grazie mille.